4 hours just to get to Denver from there, right? And so when Mike booked this flight, we're pretty sure it was the first time anybody had tried to Google a flight from Grand Junction to Halifax, okay? I gotta tell you, this is like, this is as opposite as you can get, so. But I haven't been up here in Eastern Canada in the Maritimes for a long time, and I kind of had remembered it fondly from the last time I was here, so I said, okay, I'll come up there. But you have to let me do what I do when I do my solo thing, which I do very few solo shows. But I like to actually just spend some time telling you a story related to the song or how the song came about. And this is because I started a few years ago, I found myself with a lot of time on my hands, and I started writing this blog called 300 Songs. And the stated purpose was I was just going to explain every single one of my 300 songs that I have published, right? This is actually, I will finish it one day. But I got to about 75, and I said, this is completely absorbing my entire life, and I can no longer do this, okay? So I stopped. But from that, I sort of developed these stories that are related to each of these songs. So, first of all, there's a magnificent quote about the music business from Hunter S. Thompson. Does anybody know it? Okay, it's, the music business is... what is it? The music business is a shallow money trench, a long and plastic hallway, a place where pimps and thieves run free, where good men die like dogs. And then there's a negative side. This song is called The Long Plastic Hallway, okay? And mostly because it's about one experience that I had in the music business. Now, this is a little atypical. I was in a band in Santa Cruz, California. We were very influenced by the Talking Heads and the Fall and stuff like that. This is before I was in Camper Van Beethoven. I was in Santa Cruz, California. And I had these wonderful guys that I was in the band with, one of which was this really great guitarist. His name, we'll just leave him at Chris right now. But Chris was like, he had like a PhD in playing guitar and like a sixth grade education in life. Okay? He was not the most reliable person. Okay? And he'd gone to Los Angeles to work a summer internship, right? And he started calling me halfway through the summer and saying, I got us a gig opening for the Talking Heads. This is pre-internet. This is like 1981, 82, or something like that. So I couldn't just sort of Google this, right, and find out, is he telling the truth or not? Plus, when you're 21 and you're in a band that you never heard of, that nobody's ever heard of, and somebody tells you a story like this, or tells you something like this, you want to believe it with all of your heart. You will rationalize that it's true. Even though I knew Chris wasn't very reliable, so I talked to my other bandmates. We go, well, yeah, it doesn't really sound... Well, maybe it's true. I mean, we are good. We do have a demo tape. We do sound like the Talking Heads. So, the day approached, and our drummer had started saying, well, I called my friends in Los Angeles, and we're not in any of the advertising. Well, you know, we're probably just added on at the last minute. The drummer's... calls the radio station that's presenting the show, the world famous K-Rock, and the DJs were like, we don't really know anything about you. I mean, maybe you're on the show. So we talked our friend, Joe Sloan, who's a very, very big man, which becomes important later in the story, and talked him into driving us to Los Angeles with all the gear in the back of his pickup truck, including us in the back of his pickup truck, because his girlfriend was in the truck with him. And we sat in the back of this truck and drove 400 miles to Los Angeles. And we get to the very leafy, beautiful suburb of Los Angeles known as Pasadena. It's literally where our rocket scientists live, and JPL's there, and It's just a nice place, right? You know, and this is where our guitarist was living, and his internship was with some sort of scientific company, because he was a computer guy, right? And we get there, and he's not living where he's supposed to be, right? So we start asking around and trying to figure out where he is, because he was supposed to meet us at this spot, and we were supposed to go over, you know, playing with the Talking Heads. Oh, and the other part of the story is we said, well, how is it that we're supposed to be playing with the Talking Heads? How did they get our demo tape? He goes, oh, I'm hanging out with the percussionist from the Talking Heads. And he played the tape for David Byrne, and he loved it, and so he wants us to open the show in Los Angeles. I thought, wow. Okay, so we believed it, right? Get to Los Angeles, he's not there. Starting to get suspicious. Finally, we track down where he lives. He's living with the percussionist from the Talking Heads. Yeah. And it's in this area that's called Highland Park, which was a lot worse of a neighborhood than it is now. And I wouldn't really say it was a crack house he was living in. It was more like a crack home, you know? It's a nicer place. And the percussionist from the Talking Heads is clearly a crackhead, okay? So, and Chris, unfortunately, has become a crackhead too, so, or something like that. And, yeah, hoping beyond all hope, because we do have a demo tape out, and it is really good, and we might possibly still be opening for the Talking Heads. We started peppering this guy with questions, the percussionist from the Talking Heads. And we said, well, how come we're not in any of the advertising? What time do we play? How much do we get paid? Do we have a contract? I mean, how long do we play? Anyway, we was peppered in with these questions, and finally the guy says, man, I am not talking about that gig. That is the fake gig. The real gig is on a flying saucer above Los Angeles after that gig. So at this point, Joe Sloan stares directly at the guitar player in our band and looks at him and says all of this with just one look. He says, I'm not going to kick your ass right now, but tomorrow, the next day, I'm not really sure, but I'm going to beat your ass for making me drive 400 miles down here, right? All right, so as you can tell, we didn't play with the Talking Heads. But about, I'd say 20 years later, I get invited to a show business wedding, right? And I go over and I sit down at the table, of which I'm assigned for the reception, right? And I sit down and I see that David Byrne's name is also on the table on the card, too. And so I think, David Byrne comes over, always gracious. This guy is the most gracious gentleman in rock and roll, right? Intellectual, he's a really great guy. I've never met him before, and he walks up, and we shake hands. I said, we played together once. And he says, yeah, where was that? Was that the festival, blah, blah, blah? And I go, no. He goes, was it the Jules Holland show? And I was like, oh yeah, actually we did play on the Jules Holland show together. But no, I'm not talking about that time. He goes, really? I go, yeah, it was on a flying saucer above Los Angeles. And you gotta think about like who David Byrne is and what band he's in. He gets crazy people all the time. But not usually like fellow semi-celebrities or whatever like that. And he just sort of imperceptibly moves back from me, right? Just that much, right? Yeah. And I said, yeah, you don't remember it because they erased your memory. It was on the flying saucer, they erased your memory. And he moves back a little farther. But then he surprises me because he says, well, why do you remember it? I'm one of them. Anyway, it's all good. We're all friends now. I told him it was a joke. And I apologize to him for doing that, but we've become friends since then. So. This song is called The Long Plastic Hallway, and it sort of tells the story of that. Not really. I wove it into a rock opera that Cantor Van Beethoven made in 2004. So here we go. La 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 la. Marijuana and lots of booze. Threw the flower of youth into that stew. The serpent's tongues were red and pointy, but they were wearing very cool shoes. Who wouldn't wanna sell that song? La 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 la. VIP passes, bouquets of flowers. See the brand new siren sing her song. The virgins then were thrown into volcanoes. A beating heart, it was held aloft.